Welcome to Your Voice, a program for you to see how your voice is being heard in the New York State Senate. I'm Julia Locandy. Today I'm with the Senate Finance Chairman, John DeFrancisco, and we're going to talk about the budget.
Sounds great.
So the governor gave his budget presentation this week. What do you feel about the overall message?
Well, I think the message from an economic standpoint is the right message, that we got to keep spending down. We got to cut taxes in order to allow people to actually, especially small businesses, create jobs so we have more taxpayers to pay more taxes. And I think that's a winner as far as I'm concerned, and that's what we should have been doing for many, many years in the past. We wouldn't have gotten in the problem we were in.
So how do you pay for the tax cut package, and can the state afford it?
Well, that's an interesting question, and I've been around here long enough that it's been asked on other occasions. And I remember specifically when George Pataki, who was in the Senate with me, became governor, and he proposed in the budget and got passed in the budget a substantial personal income tax decrease. And the naysayers were saying, you can't do it. What ended up happening is the economy kicked up and surpluses were developed every year, even with less tax revenue because there were more money to spend in people's pockets, and businesses were able to make money and create jobs. So I don't think we can afford not to do it, because we're not competitive with other states, and we're losing people to other states. And unless we get more competitive, it's going to get worse rather than better.
Do you think that this package is strong enough that it would prevent businesses from leaving or bring businesses into New York?
These are incremental changes. You can't make substantial. The governor's computing that his tax cut package was equivalent to about $2 billion in tax relief. Now, that sounds like a big number, but when we're so, our taxes are so high in all different areas, that is something that will help, but unless we maintain this momentum and keep doing it year after year, rather than as new revenues come in, rather than spending those new revenues, making sure that we keep this progress going. So it'll help, but it's a multi-year process.
So tough cuts, fiscal discipline, aggressive reform, that has really reined in spending and got the state out of debt. The governor wants local governments to kind of follow that lead. So can you explain Cuomo's vision for consolidation?
Well, I really think, and I've mentioned this before, I think that this was his plan since he was an attorney general, because he proposed legislation that made it easier for citizens to petition the government to put a consolidation vote on the ballot. And I think he's following through on that same theory that, you know, you can't have multi-layers of government doing many of the same things and without having taxes that are outrageous. So what I think what the governor is doing by way of his 2% tax cap is really to make sure that governments act more efficiently, and ultimately there's only so many efficiencies you can wring out of a budget. You got to consolidate, and that's basically the second theme of the State of the State message.
Right. I do want to point out that early on you knew that this is where Cuomo was going, as you said, and we do have a clip from a hearing last year where you said this. I'd just like to play that.
I think, however, my judgment, I don't think the 2% tax cap was something done simply to lower the tax burden. I think it was done also to ensure that districts will have to seriously consider consolidation because they can't afford to do anything else. And I think that's an intentional policy. And I think in the next couple of years, you're going to see a lot more consolidation.
So there's a local angle, right, that would kind of tie in with Cuomo's push to efficiently improve the municipalities.
Well, yes, there's an organization, 2020 in Syracuse, a citizens organization, and they had called about a year ago, they wanted to do a real study, a serious study on consolidation between the city and the county and between municipal governments, with villages and towns and so forth. And they approached me to try to get some funding to fund this study. And recently, the mayor and the county executive indicated they would be in favor of such study because they've already begun consolidation out of necessity, as I mentioned. So I got the funding in last year's budget, $250,000, and that funding is now being used. We're announcing the members of that commission, and there's going to be a serious study to give direction as to how our local governments could actually do that.
And they're expected to complete their analysis in about a year?
I hope less than that, but we want to get it done as quickly as possible because now there's funding in case you consolidate. You can actually get benefits from the state, more of the carrot part of this whole process, that I guess the 2% tax cap's the stick, and then the carrot is some funding to make it happen. But it's interesting in Onondaga County, what the there's one major example of a very successful consolidation when the town of Clay merged with the sheriff's department, the police of the town of Clay. It's the biggest town in my Senate district, and that was great savings to Clay. East Syracuse, a small village, wanted to merge, I believe, with the town of DeWitt. And the mayor, Danny Lika, he's no longer mayor, he's now in the county legislature, pushed hard to get that consolidation done. But it had to go to the voters, and the voters voted it down, even though it meant substantial tax increases. And I think what happens is everybody knows somebody on the police force, or everybody's in a small village, everybody is a member of the family, and it went down. Now they're reviewing it again. Now Danny Leek is no longer mayor, and there's a push in East Syracuse, now that they got their tax bills, to show that maybe we made a mistake. And hopefully examples of that will start this thing moving in the right direction, and time will tell whether that happens.
And there is more information on your website, defrancisco.nysenate.gov. The public budget hearings on some major programs begin next week. Let's run through the schedule as we talk about it. You will lead all the hearings as the Senate Finance Chairman.
Yes, I do it jointly with my counterpart in the Assembly, Denny Farrell, who is the Chairman of Ways and Means. And as you can see, the first one is local and general government. That's going to be interesting because the new mayor of New York City, de Blasio, is going to be there. Mm-hmm. Be interesting to see now that the governor is proposing to fund pre-K, why he still insists on the state giving him authority to raise taxes. Totally different philosophy than I have, so it'll be interesting to hear what he's got to say. Mayor Minor will be there, no doubt, and other mayors throughout the state. Transportation, always a big issue. That'll be on the 30th. And it goes on like that for a long time, as you'll see. They start next Monday, and they'll continue on for 3.5 weeks. Mm-hmm. And it's basically the legislature, now that the governor's done his job, laid out the state of the state, talked about the financial condition and what he's doing financially in his budget remarks. Now the purpose of all these hearings is to give people say about what the governor proposed, and for the legislators to ask questions, so that what will happen is that the Senate, after we get our point of view together, we will pass a one house budget, just the Senate. Assembly will do the same, and then we'll start joint conference committees to try to reconcile the differences to have an on-time budget for the fourth year in a row.
Right, and these hearings can be seen on the Legislative Proceedings Channel, 83 in Syracuse.
That is correct.
And live on the website.
That's correct. They are long, sometimes very burdensome. Long. Sometimes questions aren't the sharpest questions. Sometimes the answers are ones that avoid the question. But it's instructive to see how government works. And if you have a specific area that you're interested in, and you didn't get the actual date that's going to be on or the time, so you can just hone in on those areas you want, I'm sure we will have it on our website.
So the tax package that the governor has proposed, is that distributed across all the sectors?
Yeah, it really is, but it depends on what sector you're part of. Some say they didn't get any relief. Others say they got that others got more relief, and it's just not fair. And you can go through all that. But the key ones, eliminating the corporate tax on manufacturers. That is huge because manufacturing requires other products, other supplies. It spins off to so many more jobs for those supplying the manufacturers. Corporate tax cut is truly across the board, whether you're a big corporation or whether you're a small corporation. And so some are across the board cuts. The estate tax, you could be a rich person and want to leave the state because your estate's going to be taxed when it's not taxed in other states. Or you could be a farmer who is a property rich and cash poor, where you have to sell the family farm because the value of the land is so great that you can't keep it going. So that cuts across all economic lines, the estate tax reform. And so I think it's I prefer all of the proposals that we came up with in the Senate. Some of the things I have my doubts about as far as the governor's proposals, but will hopefully come to an agreement and a good one.
So now's the time to make your voice heard when it comes to the budget items. So if you have any questions about the budget or the process, defrancisco.nysenate.gov. So will there be a budget by April 1st, you believe?
In the past, I would say, who knows? But in view of the last three on-time budgets, I would be shocked if we didn't have an on-time budget this year. The governor is showing much more leadership than his immediate predecessors, and I think it's very, very likely.
I would like to give our viewers an update on the collection for cell phones for soldiers, because you had a record-breaking success.
Yeah, as you can see, we got a lot of boxes of cell phones that have been donated, a lot of the drop situations, and there was over 1,500 phones that were dropped off, which translates into 3,000 hours of free phone time from overseas by military personnel to their family, and that's, to me, that's really a significant effort by all the people in the community that donated those used cell phones for an excellent cause.
Right. And you've been doing it for 6 years, and I think it's 7,500 phones you've collected over that time.
Yes, it built up over the years, and it's a lot of free hours of calls from overseas that it's the least we can do for our servicemen.
Absolutely. So strengthening criminal statutes relating to ethics reform, do you think that's going to be in or out of the budget, real quick?
I don't think it's going to be in the budget. I just think it's so controversial. Public financing campaigns, the Senate, myself included, do not like it, at least the Republicans in the Senate. And I can debate that any day of the week, and we'll talk about maybe that on one show later on.
Yeah. What came of the hearing that you had last year on that?
Well, what came of the hearing is we questioned many people, including the Commissioner of Elections, whatever the term is or whatever the formal name is, of New York City that has it. Mm-hmm. And we found out that they still hadn't audited their candidates from 4 years earlier. So how do you control spending or control gifts if you don't even audit what you're doing in a timely fashion? Secondly, it pointed out that Vito Lopez, who was resigned for groping women or alleged to have groped a woman, and Weiner, I forgot his first name, Congressman
Anthony.
I seem to block that. Both of them ran for office in New York City and got public finance dollars, taxpayers' money, to keep them going in politics. I don't want to support people with my taxpayers' money that I don't philosophically agree with.
I agree. All right. Thank you so much for being here, Senator.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For more information on how the budget process works or to watch the budget hearings live, log on to the Senator's website, defrancisco.nysenate.gov.